sucks or worse. So, in any case, lots of different reasons why we do not follow what our caregivers tell us to do. So even as we want collaboration, we want all this stuff, sometimes we are our own worst enemies as patients. There's another section on care providers' investment. And that's basically the idea that sometimes cooperation isn't always there, has a lot of potential side effects. And even caregivers can be damaged if they consistently screw up. So we're in this together. When patients and health professionals don't see eye to eye, the following adverse effects are likely: treatment failures, you know, frustration, you know, wasted time, yeah, loss of professional reputation or privilege for the caregiver, risks to public health, yeah, and death.
It may cause treatment failures, frustration, wasted time, avoidable expenses, loss of professional reputation, whatever. Void where prohibited.
And then they talk about informed consent and all the bad studies, like the Tuskegee syphilis study. And that's why we have informed consent, by the way. For those of you who've ever taken research classes from me, the IRB, Institutional Review Board, everybody who's doing research, medical field or whatever, has to go through some sort of IRB process where the folks who are involved in the process, the study, the participants, have to sign informed consent stuff so they know what they're getting into. So folks need to be informed, which is all part of patient empowerment and this idea of patient empowerment and all this other stuff that you can read about careers and patient advocacy is all part of this collaborative model where power is equal. So lots of interesting things about issues of satisfaction and issues of how doctors and patients or caregivers and patients cooperate and all that type of stuff. Pretty interesting stuff. Then, toward the end, there's a really interesting section on illness and identity. One thing that's really important to understand is what's identity in the first place. And I think the book actually does a pretty good job of that. I don't know anything about this guy, poor guy, but sort of cool. Not cool that he died, but cool that he told his story and became part of his identity, Stephen's story. Contemporary identity theory, we do not have some sort of, we have like DNA and stuff like that, I guess, I don't know. But the whole sense that we are some sort of static me, I need to try to find a true sense of self. Who am I? We move around. I mean, identity is fluid and it is performed, it is communicated. It's not in here, it's out there. When we do get sick, obviously, it impacts how we see ourselves, how other people see us. We have a sense of personal identity. And it's pretty interesting when it talks about issues of Michael Arrington's research on issues of prostate cancer and manhood and masculinity. And it's interesting how manhood and masculinity oftentimes is reduced to the erect penis. That's pretty much it, yeah. So if they can't, men can't do that, they, but in any case, it's pretty, So obviously, medical situations can have a huge impact on folks' personal identity. And also we deal with social identities, how we perceive ourselves in relationship to our social groups and how that might impact everything. Talks about irritable bowel disease. And then we have tertiary identity. And then this is the big sort of thing, I think. It says, when people are diagnosed with identity-threatening illnesses, their health status may become part of their identity as well. Jake Harwood and Lisa Sparks call this tertiary identity, a label that defines simultaneously the illness and the person's alignment toward it. So, and using terminology like victim versus survivor, blah, 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 blah. So, long story short, obviously illness and our health, all that type of stuff impacts our many layers of identity. And particularly if there's some serious things going on, long-term illnesses, research by Kathy Karmaz shows us that we oftentimes go through four stages, even though people might not always do that. First, we take on a super normal identity. You're so normal, you are super normal. It's like, oh, I've been diagnosed with this thing, but you know, I'm gonna beat it. I'm going to be better than I ever was before. I'm going to make lemonade out of lemons. Lemonade. Tasty. So refreshing. And then after you've got this super normal, they say, or Kathy says, this stage is usually followed by a sense of restored self in which people are not quite as optimistic and typically deny that the illness has changed them. It's like, oh, this is going to make me a better person. Like, I'm just same old me. And then the third stage is contingent personal identity, in which people admit they may not be able to do everything they could. Well, I couldn't always. I could. Yeah, I used to be able to do that. My mom does this a lot. It's just, well, you know, before the cancer, I could do this, but now, you know. And then finally, the salvaged self, which sounds just horrible. That's why the first thing that came to my mind was a salvage yard. So that's why I have a picture of a salvage yard. Represents the development of a transformed identity that integrates former aspects of self with current limitations. Right. So this is me. I have salvaged my life. Yes. Pretty interesting. Some ending comments here about this whole chapter. It was really interesting looking at issues of identity and the corporatization, particularly of breast cancer. But that's pretty, it's a big complex thing. You probably saw, I don't know all the details about the Susan Komen sort of thing. But yeah, people are sort of making money off of other people's suffering. And, you know, the market, breast cancer is now part of the market economy. We have pink ribbons and scarves and bears and t-shirts and coffee mugs and wind chimes and breast cancer candles and what the hell is that? Something galore, I don't know what that word is. There's something offensive about this person says. Most of these items advertise that part of the proceeds go to breast cancer research. I wonder how much and to what end. And this, she, Lee Ford, Bridget, talked to somebody, Helen, okay. Questioned the pink ribbon movement, emphasis on feminine beauty, optimism, and survival. If you refuse to enact the role of the noble survivor, you are invisible or marginalized. The tyranny of the cheerfulness, this particular person calls it. Which, you know, all that stuff can be interesting. Okay, so the last implications, I think they're pretty interesting for communication concerning illness and personal identity. Remember, we're still in the personal identity section. Talk about narratives as a way to convey and establish and negotiate self-identity. So there's values in storytelling and listening when you are suffering from some sort of illness and trying to figure out, you know, who you are. Avoid preconceived notions about how people will or should respond to a health crisis. That's good. Don't, you know, you're going to beat it. You are now going through a super normal phase. Recognize that personal identity is fluid, so that changes over time. When physical treatment goals are at odds with identity goals, they often are. Communicate openly and collaboratively about the differences, blah, blah, blah. Do not underestimate the accuracy of superficial cues. People who seem to be taking things well may be avoiding the issue. One fine. Be careful about the words you use. Survivor supports a different identity than victim. Also, pay attention to the words other people use. These may present openings for conversation, as in, you refer to yourself as a Crip since the accident. Do you feel that people treat you that way? Yeah. Who would say that? Okay, so, at the end of the day, what was this chapter all about? Patience, be patient. I really like these, this book actually has a really, some good summaries in them. Not that you should do the old stupid thing and just read the summaries. People who, in contrast to the well-established ways, I'm reading it, in which caregivers are socialized, people learn how to be patients, mostly through life experiences and watching others. Patients often communicate in hesitant and non-assertive ways because they are uncertain what is expected of them and afraid to seem rude or ignorant. So all of this is really about how do we know how to be patients and communicate. And there are some things that we do poorly, some things that we can improve. But as we are learning to be better communicators, better health communicators, we have to be patient. Pum, pum, pum. Okay, that's